Welcome to Lunch with the Lord. I'm Pastor Mark. We're in Nehemiah chapter 4. We're going to be looking at verses 9 and 10 this lesson. But before we begin, Jeremiah 15, 16, thy words were found, and I did eat them. And thy word was unto me the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. Now, as we begin verses 9 and 10, we know from last lesson, the Jews built the wall up to the half of the height. They're closing up the holes in the wall, the breaches, and the enemy is angry because they don't like it. So now we get into verses 9 and 10. And it says here, nevertheless, we made our prayer unto our God, and we set a watch against them day and night because of them. And Judah said, the strength of the bearers of burdens is decayed, and there is much rubbish, so that we are not able to build the wall. Now, again, this prayer that they pray in verse 9 comes right after verse 8, which says, and they conspired, meaning the enemies conspired, all of them together, to come against and to fight Jerusalem and to hinder it. And we said that the Ashdodites represent the west side of Jerusalem. So they were surrounded. And when it says that all of them conspired, it means they were coming from all, they represented all areas around Jerusalem to come and fight against these Jews. But again, did they really mean to fight? Probably not, because they would know that Nehemiah had direct authority from the king himself to build these walls. So any physical action against the Jews would be going against the king's actual decree. So yeah, you don't want to get the king upset. So now in verse 9, again, he says, we made our prayer to our God. We set up a watch against them day and night because of them. Now, now that the holes in the wall have been closed up, there are two things that every Christian needs to do. The first one is pray, and the second one is be watching day and night. This is what it says here in verse 9. Nevertheless, after the breaches are being closed up, verse 9 says, we made our prayer, number one, we prayed to God, and number two, they set a watch against them day and night. Whether a Christian is continuing on in their relationship with God, or whether they are returning to the Lord after a time of backsliding, prayer must be part of their regular daily life. In Ephesians chapter 6 and verse 18, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit. Praying what? Praying always. In Colossians chapter 4 and verse 12, it says that Epaphras was always laboring. How? How was he laboring? He was laboring fervently for the Colossians in their prayers, in his prayers. In his prayers, he was laboring fervently for these Colossian believers. Don't let prayer be just once in the morning and once at night. It says, pray throughout the day. For all things. Listen, God is interested in every detail of your life. Don't think that something is so, I got to wash the dishes now. I mean, God ain't interested in that. I can give him a break. I'll let him deal with somebody else's problems somewhere else in the world. No. God is interested in every single detail of your life. So we need to pray throughout the day, not just once in the morning and once at night. It's not enough. We need to include God in every area of our life. We need God's protection and God's provision against our enemies. You can have enemies while you're washing dishes. You can have enemies while you're driving in the car to the supermarket or wherever you're going. You can have enemies. Just turn on that radio. You got enemies coming out of there, unless you listen to Christian radio. But you have enemies from where, all places. We also need to be watching continually. He says two things in this verse, verse 9. He says, we made our prayer and we set a watch. We made our prayer and we set a watch. So we also need to be watching continually. Take no vacations. In Ephesians chapter 6, verse 18, which we just quoted, it says, we always pray and we watch with what? We watch with perseverance. In 1 Corinthians 16, verse 13, it says, watch and stand fast in the faith. In 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 5, it says, watch in all things. Watch in what? In all things. Listen, are we watching in all things? Or do we stop watching when we go to work or when we go to school? Or when do we stop watching when we go on vacation? I need a break from watching. I'm tired of watching, right? No, we need to watch on vacation. We need to, do we continue to watch while we are visiting family or when we go to the store shopping? Listen, our enemy is walking around day and night looking for someone to devour. It says in 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8, we have an enemy and he is walking day and night continuously looking for someone to devour. If we let our guard down and stop watching, the enemy is going to be right there. He's going to be right there. Pray and watch. Pray throughout the day and be watching throughout the day. Now, this unity between prayer and watching, or prayer and action, is something that is mentioned several times in this book of Nehemiah. The first time we see it, well, the first time we actually saw it was back in chapter 2, verses 4 and 5, where it says, so I prayed to the Lord of heaven, to the God of heaven, and I said, so prayer, I prayed to the Lord God of heaven, and I said, I acted, I spoke. Then the second time we see it is in Nehemiah chapter 4, verses 4 through 6. It says, hear, O our God, he's praying, and so we built. In verse 6, they're praying, and in verse 4 and in verse 6, so we built, we continued, we acted. The third time we see it is right here in our context in Nehemiah 4, verse 9, where we see prayer and watching. Again, prayer and action, prayer and watching. And the next time we're going to see it is down in verse 14 of this same chapter, chapter 4, where it says, Remember the Lord, which is great and terrible. That's the prayer. Remember the Lord who is great and terrible. And what? And fight for your brethren. So we see this unity between prayer and action. There are times when prayer should be followed by action. There's times in our life when we should be able to say, I prayed and then I talked. I prayed and then I drove. I prayed and then I taught, or I started the Bible study, or I sang in the church choir. I prayed and then I acted on something for God. Prayer should be such a part of our life that in whatever we do, we pray first. Include God in all things of your life. I prayed and then I wrote the letter. I prayed and then I called someone on the phone. It's prayer and action. Now, verse 10, and Judah said, the strength of the bearers of burdens is decayed, and there is much rubbish, so that we are not able to build the wall. Now, one of the great weapons that is used against God's people is the weapon of discouragement. They were successful in closing up the wall, and they were well on their way to finishing the wall. But then it says they looked at the rubbish and they felt their weakness and began to doubt if they could finish. So it was, in a sense, it wasn't the enemies that were discouraging them. They were getting weak physically from building, and they looked around and they thought to themselves, we still have all this stuff to do. I'm tired, right? And it was, in a sense, it wasn't the enemy that was discouraging them. It was the what they looked upon, the rest of the work, the amount of work that they thought needed to be done. And so here they're getting discouraged. And sometimes the enemy, our enemy, can cause us to look at how much more work we've got. And we can get discouraged in our heart. And you know, Satan and his kingdom may say, yeah, you know what, you're doing a great work, but you're just not anywhere near the end. You've got so much more to do. And I know you're tired. And I know you put so much effort into it. You're getting mentally tired. And you've got to slow down. I mean, there's a vast amount of work yet to be done. You might as well take a rest, slow down, right? This is what the enemy does. It wasn't that they looked out and they saw an enemy. It's just they saw their work. Their eyes were now focused on the work. And they got discouraged because they thought of how much more we have to do to finish this. When the enemy sees that he has no effect upon us and that the work is soon to be finished, whispers of doubt, whispers of the great amount of work that still needs to be done begins to come in. There's too much work. It will take long hours away from your family, away from your study time. A lot of people will resist. You don't have the proper experience to do this. You're not qualified to do this thing for God, right? Remember the people that were building the walls? What, we had pharmacists building the walls. We had people working with jewelry building the walls. These weren't wall builders. They had women building the walls, right? Satan's going to come in. He's going to tell you you're not qualified. You can't be doing this. And all kinds of doubts and fears come in because you see the amount of work that needs to be done and the kind of work. And you look at yourself and you say, I guess I'm not qualified. He's got you. They looked at the work and they looked at themselves and they doubted if they could finish this job. They were almost there. They had the wall at least half filled. And now the enemy comes in and trying to use discouragement to keep them from finishing the job. They were tired and they were weak, and they saw that in parts only half the wall was built up. In parts of the city, only half the wall was built up. They concluded that they were not able to build the wall. That they had great doubts in their heart that they would be able to finish this because they're tired and they're physically weak and the rubbish is all around, and we still have a lot more work to do. And they were just getting discouraged. If God has called us to do something, then he will be our strength and our provision. The closer to the end that you get, the stronger the opposition. The opposition is very worried. And you know what? If the opposition is worried, that's good. That's good. If your enemy is worried about you completing this project, that's a good sign. You want the enemy worried. You don't want to be the ones worried. No. When you're worried, the enemy is happy. When the enemy is worried, you're happy because things are going right. You're almost finished. No, we need to make the enemy worried. In Joshua chapter 1, verses 1 through 7, it says, "Now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spoke unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, he is dead. Now therefore arise and go over this Jordan, you and all the people, unto the land which I do give to them, even to the children of Israel, every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given unto you, as I said unto Moses, from the wilderness and this Lebanon, even unto the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, and unto the great sea toward the going down of the sun shall be your coast. There shall not be any able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. You will not fail, and I will not fail you nor forsake you. Be strong and of good courage, for unto this people shall you divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them." Listen, verse 7, "Only be thou strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded thee. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go." And then in 2 Chronicles chapter 32, verses 6 through 8, and it says here, "And he set captains of war over the people, and gathered them together to him in the street of the gate of the city, and he spoke comfortably to them, saying, Be strong and courageous, be not afraid nor dismayed for this the king of Assyria, nor for the multitude that is with him, for there be more with us than with him. With him is an arm of flesh, but with us, what? Is the Lord our God to help us and to fight our battles. And the people rested themselves upon the words of Hezekiah, king of Judah." That's what we need to do. Listen, we need to rest ourselves upon the word of God, upon the calling of God on our life. We need to rest. We need to make the enemy worried. We're the ones that should be resting, not the enemy. If the enemy's resting, it means we're worried and all bent out of shape. No, we're the ones who needs to be resting upon God's word. We need to be ones to be occupied in the wall, not worried about the enemy, occupied building the wall, continue to build. And we need to trust God when we feel a little tired. We don't want to get discouraged. We don't want to look at the situation, because if you look at the situation, you will get discouraged. Why? Because this is a work of God. This is a work that only God can do. We, in our human strength, we can't do it. This is not our work. This is not something we have to do in our strength for God. This is something God is doing through us. And we need to trust God and put our faith in his promises and what he has called us to do. Why? Because God's called us, he's going to do it. So we need to trust him in the things that he has called us to do. To build the wall, do whatever God has called you to do. Don't listen to the whispers of the enemy. All right, we're going to start verse 11 next lesson. But until then, walk with the Lord. I know he walks with you.